welcome to another Exchange for Media Pitch Live, the brand talk with brand and business leaders. Today we have a special guest, Mr. Sachin Jain, who really doesn't need an introduction. He is the CEO and MD of the largest diamond company in India, and diamonds are forever. Welcome, Mr. Jain. We're delighted that we are talking to you. And this,
thank you, Anurag. It's a pleasure to be here.
This conversation
always a pleasure
is not
to see
only
you.
On Zoom, but it is live on Exchange for Media pages, exchangeformedia.com, pitchonnet.com, and impactonnet.com. So, Sachin, how have been the last 90 days for you? You look healthy, happy, cheerful.
Well, Anurag, first and foremost, many thanks for inviting me. It's always a pleasure to interact with you and be on your platforms. They're always the most important platforms for anybody to refer to any business documentation. And I'm a big fan for all your streams. So thanks for inviting me.
Very kind. Kindness is the most important trait leaders
have. I really believe on the work that you and your team does is phenomenal. And big congratulations. And you continued the whole stride during the lockdown. Now, you know, you're asking about the last 90 days. I think like all of us, we've had a very different life in the last 90 days. Fortunately for me, I've been at home, which has never happened. So, first new for me, I'm sure perhaps for you as well, we made the most of it. Technology helped. And I feel on the work side of it, I think I feel really proud of my team and the team that I work with and the team that I'm part of, that we all were able to seamlessly integrate, work together, bring effectiveness. Yes, it was quite, the world right now is quite anxious in terms of what the future will hold. But all of us are doing our bit to unfold this whole mystery, getting more clearer. And I think in some form, shape or size, moving towards normalcy. So interesting times in the last 90 days, Anurag. And I'm happy that, we're all getting out of it in some manner. And normalcy is around the corner.
Thank you, Sachin, on that positive and, note and looking at the bright side. You talk about how your team has rallied to support you to do the operations virtually and, shown tremendous resilience. We live in VUCA times. It's volatile. If this is not volatile, they're uncertain. We can't see beyond certain weeks, maybe a week, 2 weeks. They're complex and there is ambiguity, So tell us, what are your personal takeaways in the last 90 days on what leaders should do to navigate themselves and navigate the teams that they lead?
I think first and foremost, Anurag, and I can tell you one of my very important learnings has been that, when we are in this, when we are in this race and we are running to catch up from one meeting to the other, one delivery to the other, I think, and I'm sure you would resonate as well, we perhaps not get the time to sort of stall and reflect. And I think I can vouch for myself. I have never actually taken reflection seriously. This was a time when you were forced into being alone, you were forced into sort of having perhaps a little more time initially on hand. And I think as business leaders, as someone like me, I mean, I reflected and you could chart out your future in a certain manner, which we don't get as leaders. And I think that's one of my most important learnings to sort of carve out time for reflection. I would suggest people who are on the call to perhaps put some time for reflection in your calendar. So it's not just incidental, you put it up. So you plan your life ahead of you. I think that was an important learning. For us at De Beers, if I move and reflect back onto my life, there are a lot of values by which our organization runs. And, this was a very important time when you see, these values are not just theoretic things that you stick on walls. It's not just when you show a big fancy presentation to people who join your organization. It was a time to live those values. And the merit of thing that I stand for a few things as an organization and the people stand for those things, I saw them happening live. So to share with you, like for example, we have some of the values. One of them is show we care. One of them is pulling together. And I already talked about the way our team had pulled together, but also show we care and how we treat safety. These are three of very pillars on which the organization runs. We saw them in action. We saw them really happening on ground, right from the communities where we mine in Africa and what we were able to do with them. And we got resonation to right from the end to our employees, to the consumers. So that was pretty interesting. And one of our values is shaping the future. So now the ball is in our court. All that had to happen has happened. Now, if the future is different and is, as you said, is ambiguous, it's volatile, I mean, shape the future boldly into this new world. And that's what we, again, I reflect back as to how these values that are inculcated in all of us as a team have actually played out. I feel proud about that.
Thank you, Sachin. Actually, we've all slowed down relatively. I know we get more calls, we're doing more video interactions, but overall we slowed down because we're staying in homes. We're not traveling. We're saving a 2-hour travel. We're not doing breakfast, lunches, dinners with business associates. I mean, I'm sure you miss a bit of it. But overall, we're doing okay because we are serving a higher purpose. And you rightly said that all the values that the organizations stood for have come to the fore. They have been, you know, actualized. Now, I want to ask you a little bit about, you know, diamonds are luxury, so to say, right? Diamonds are luxury, right? At least traditionally. Diamonds are luxury, I said.
Sorry, Anurag, I had a bit of issue on my... Yeah.
I said diamonds are typically luxury.
Yeah.
Right? And last 90 days, people have kind of lived with the motto, less is more. So tell us in this, and if I may dare say, gold has become 50,000 rupees. Look at where gold has gone.
Sure.
Right? So, you know, do you think diamonds will also become even more valuable as people... Because, you know, they're wealth too in some way.
Certainly. I think you're absolutely right. And the fact is that there are two important things that we've seen emerge in this lockdown as consumers. First and foremost is consciousness. You know, and consciousness, I'm not reflecting about, you know, my care for Mother Earth and all of that. That's one part of it. Consciousness to say that, do I even need to buy anything? I mean, life is like the sense of contentment and the whole aspect about, you know, life is good. I mean, you know, God's given me enough. There's a sense of gratitude that's come up. And connected to that, I think we've been researching consumers a lot. And we believe that fewer better things will be important. You know, you'll buy less, but you'll buy what is valuable, what matters to you. Relationships will matter more. Yeah. As I said, there's sensibility to a natural world that is emerging, right? And all of them, actually, ironically, connect back to the beauty or the grace or the rarity of what diamonds are. And I think in some, I mean, I do understand the short term, there's, of course, a lack of demand and all of those things. But we think fundamentally, the way consumers are moving towards a different consumption, diamonds actually fit in beautifully. Now, what changes for us really will be, you know, simplicity is a very important game, right? It's the whole opulence or showing to my neighbor or getting into that party and showing off my big rocks or my huge jewelry pieces is going to take a big bit of beating. And I think as marketeers, if we keep on top of the trends of how consumers are moving in or how they're navigating through different needs, we believe that we fundamentally have an extremely strong product. I mean, diamonds itself is a gift of Mother Nature, you know, and that rarity, that timelessness, that endurability, that, you know, every diamond holds value. It's not like a expense on luxury where, you know, it's not a store of wealth.
It's not a depreciating asset.
It's not a depreciating
the
asset.
Value doesn't go away.
Exactly. Right? So all of
you
this.
Buy a luxury play. Car, the moment you drive it out, 30% value gone in every other 10% erode.
Absolutely. So I think from all that aspect, things are in our stride. But I wish and I hope that all of our industry, you know, picks up these new sort of trends of the consumer and we do well. That's one part of it. The other part of it is actually, you know, the whole manufacturing for which India is so well known. I mean, I would love to share with your listeners that 14 out of 15 diamonds that are produced in the world or manufactured in the world come from India. Now, India plays an extremely huge role in the manufacturing of diamonds. And the unique part about this lockdown has been that everything is stalled. So the mining is stalled, the manufacturing is stalled, the retail stores are shut, you know, and there's a pause to pretty much everything. So when we got into lockdown, you know, we were having a whole lot of discussions that, oh man, will the prices fall down? Will the demand and supply go, you know, cross? And the fact is, since everything is stalled, it's been quite consistent in the way it's opening up. So, for example, our mining operations have also opened up in a very small manner. Manufacturing also has opened up in a very small manner. Interestingly, certain countries like China, their demand is going up very, very, very wide. So we hope and the way it's, you know, steering it, the fact that we believe that fewer better things, respect to certain relationships. And I think in all this new era of what consumers are thinking, we'll fit in well. It'll be a different world, without doubt. What worked in the past is certainly not going to work in the future. And hence, agility for any business. I'm sure we are, I'm sure you're talking to a variety of businesses. And I really don't know what is a travel and business doing, really. But I think the headwinds are of different speeds in different industries. I believe that in the business of diamonds, the headwinds are there. But the fundamental belief of what we are doing and what a product stands for is also permanent. So we have to navigate this.
Thank you, Sachin, for being authentic and dealing with what we are discussing very directly. Now, coming back to consumers in marketing, as you yourself referred that the consumer behavior has changed. Some of it may be temporary, but some of it may be permanent changes. Tell us, from where you sit, what do you see are the temporary changes and what do you see are the permanent changes?
I think first and foremost, let's reflect on the immediate issues, so to say. So when the lockdown started, we heard news about China revival and the great numbers coming from China. This happened just in the first week of April, end of March, April, we started hearing it. Honestly, I wasn't too clear about those numbers at that point in time until we have large scale operation in China. And when I saw those numbers, I was baffled. And I was baffled with a few things. I was baffled with the speed of recovery, with the speed in which consumers came back to normal life, the speed at which they were buying luxury and diamonds. And there were discussions internally that will this get replicated in our market in India? And the answer is no. The fact is that the way we consume luxury, the way we deal with life is very different. And you talked about ambiguity. I think all of us are fully ambiguous in our minds right now. So short term, I think it's about the core necessities, the basic survival. It's all those things that are clogging up everybody's mind. I mean, I have friends in retail business where we are seeing consumption of fitness equipment going up and fitness gear going up, not necessarily diamonds. Today we are in the fourth week when Bangalore opened, for example. We are at about 30 to 40% recovery. Various other parts of India are between 25% to about 40% as well. We think that a big comeback should be around September, end October, where we should be about, I would say, 60 to 70% recovered if we do things well. And perhaps a much stronger recovery in 2021. So I'll be honest about it too. So there's no magic wand in front of us to say, leave aside COVID, it's not going to impact. Because people, there is a large chunk of population that is economically moved with it. And that's impactful. The other, there's one interesting segment, and I presume a lot of your viewers might be catering to those segments as well. And there is one segment of, HNIs and people who are not actually economically impacted by COVID. And in the sense of luxury, I can say that there's a sense of guilt, the sense of reluctance that they're facing, although they want to buy, but something's holding them back. And I think if we do as marketeers, if we approach this segment logically, I'm not saying blatantly, there's the concept of saying, come out and buy my product at 25% discount is out. I mean, don't do that. But if we address logically this segment, I think short-term sorrows can be taken care of. So, I mean, they hold a lot of potential.
What Sachin Jain is saying, there is a short-term sorrow, but hopefully there will be a long-term joy, even a mid-term happiness, if I may use that.
Yeah. I might want to add, Anurag, that, also as marketeers, it is, we invest crazy amounts of monies and energies on researching and understanding what's going on in consumers' mind. I believe that while we are in this phase where everybody's saying, let's invest less and let's control our expenses, I would suggest not to sort of tamper on your research and marketing budget. Firstly, I say that know what your consumers are thinking about your industry, what's going on in their mind, and what that would mean to your short-term
strategy. It's very dynamic. And dare I say, it's very dynamic. So you've got to keep...
Totally.
You've got to deep dive into that.
Totally. And when you started, you mentioned about this, and I'll repeat that. The eras of long-term planning, here is where my organization and brand will be in 5 years and 7 years. All those have become history already. But in these times, if you're not on top of the pulse of the consumer in your market today, perhaps you lose out. I mean, in our case, I'll tell you, we started, south of India started better. Chennai is getting into lockdown tomorrow. Now, it's so important for us to figure out what's happening with that geography of consumer and what is my mitigation strategy. I think it's more become month on month to week on week and stuff like that. Dan saying, let's talk about 5 years and where will we in 5 years, because who knows whether we'll be existing in 5 years or not. So agility and really knowing what the consumer's mind is thinking today is important.
Rightly said, agility, if I may say, understanding where the consumers are putting their money.
Totally.
Where their heart is. So I think you have to understand this. And Sachin, I keep saying we've become a 3C economy. Contactless, we're talking without meeting. The last conversation was in a hotel on a stage. We are doing it through a video technology. So contactless. Second is caring. You talked about it, you know, you talked about your team. You talked about how even in your mining operations. And third is collaborative. As a leader, tell us how these three are impacting your business, especially collaboration.
I think hugely, Anurag. We have been a very traditional business in a lot of senses. You know, there's a traditional cutting industry. There's a traditional retailing industry. And we are miners. And, you know, if you talk to anybody in this business, we three are disconnected but connected sort of different worlds. And in the last 3 months, the amount of openness, collaboration, the amount of saying that let's build the future together has been, you know, unprecedented. And the fact is that we all know as modern business leaders that challenges might look different, but in context, they're very similar. So I think you're absolutely right that collaboration will be important. The other aspect you talked about is contactless, which I would, you know, maybe expand a little more, is the usage of technology, which is going to be humongous. And in our kind of world where everything was physical, where, you know, when we sell out rough diamonds, our buyers would look at it with an eyeglass, travel, you know, 20 hours into a flight into Botswana, look at every single rough diamond and then purchase, and then full physicality in our B2B world was humongous. I mean, until the lockdown hit us, there was no alternative to a physical world. And I think that's going to go through a humongous change. So all of that is already happening. But also the retail side. I think, you know, there's a lot of SOPs that everybody is now implemented around safety and all of those things. But certainly there'll be a huge impact on technology, on the retail world itself. So that consumers who were earlier coming in, I mean, an average time you spent to buy, you know, a necklace or a piece of jewelry was anywhere from 30 minutes to 2 hours, where a family would come in, sit, have some snacks, get some drinks, you know, come three times. I think that's not going to be the way forward. And it is our role to bring in smartness or giving them solutions which are quicker, solutions which are perhaps technology-based, that all of that meeting and that greeting perhaps can happen in a form and break down the timing so that people come in and go out safely. They go out with less of an of crowding in places and so on and so forth. But you're right, contactless with technology. And I would say collaboration is the key of the future.
Thank you, Sachin. I want to go back. You said the marketer should not cut budgets on research and should not cut budgets on marketing. Can you elaborate? You elaborated on the research side. Can you dwell on the marketing side?
So for I think what I meant for marketing was...
Has business leaders and marketers gone on a pause in the last 90 days and not communicated? Of course, in some markets, as you said, the markets were open or were open for a brief time. Right. Others are closed. So what have you done with your marketing?
I'll tell you, Anurag. So for us, you know, when we all got into lockdown, it was a bit of, you know, what hit us? You know, what the hell happened kind of thing. And there was a bit of scare and clarity. So at that time, the role that we took on was, first and foremost, we decided that we will not lose connection with our consumers. So of course, at that time, the mediums were very different. Digital, of course, was taking the lead. And at that time, we stayed connected with our consumers. And at that era, the whole discussions were around, or the conversation was around faith, holding hand, you know, better times ahead, that sort of feeling. What's happened in the last 3 months really is that there's a humongous amount of negativity that's gone around consumers' mind. I mean, you know, right from news to, you know, neighbor who's impacted, ambiguity, job losses and all of that. So it's been a lot of negative. And I think in everybody needs to recognize what is the role of their business. And in our case, one of the roles of the business of diamonds is happiness, is joy, is cheer. And I'm saying that there has to be a mid path between moving from extreme negativity to starting conversations which are cheerful a bit joyful. And again, I'm not saying...
And give hope. You know, we are sensitive and mindful of what's happening around us.
Exactly.
But at the same time, we have to give hope to every individual to kind of cross that bridge.
Right. And while all of us have those business targets to meet, we need to be extremely conscious that don't consider a consumer, you know, outside of the picture. If you start telling him that, here's our product, you know, it's 200,000 rupees, that many EMI, and whatever to come and buy, I think you'll piss off the consumer more. I think you have to recognize that he's into this. He's also crossing that bridge from, you know, extreme negativity to a bit of hope. And if you're ambassadors of the hope, and that's the role that marketing needs to do today. You know, the fact is that IPL is not happening. The Olympics are gone. Any form of, you know, form of joy is all out of the picture.
No new movies are coming up. Except
and people are stuck in home. I mean, I have a young daughter, and the fact is that it's perhaps the first time that in summer vacations you're home and the schools will start again. So we need to be cognizant of that and be ambassadors of a bit of cheer. And I think this is really coming from the fact that you really know and you're top of where your consumers are. So I think that'll be phase two. And really the phase three will be when we say, let's press pedal on revival. When it'll be about numbers and I think you're staying connected to the consumers will play a role. Now, to your question of marketing, I think the role of marketing will be around staying connected and using the right messaging in different times of when this change is happening. But completely boycotting marketing perhaps will be a wrong decision, particularly for industries or categories like ours, which are, you know, luxury, non-discretionary, and stuff like that. And I would say that this should be a consistent effort. We should not break this whole connectivity that we've had with our consumers. It's going to play
what Sachin Jain is saying is the brands need to communicate continuously with their consumers, build that relationship, showcase that relationship possibly in these times and not cut the connection.
Because, totally.
Yes, these are temporary times and dare I say, this shall too pass.
So, totally.
Sachin, I want to ask you my last two questions. I was talking to a leader from the technology industry. And I asked him, what are the top three skills required to be successful as a leader? I was talking to Karan Bajwa, who's the CEO of Google Cloud. And he said, resilience. He said, the ability to deal with ambiguity. And third, he said, the ability to resolve conflicts. So tell us, as a leader, what are the qualities that you feel would be required in a post-COVID world? Of course, some will always remain there, of being empathetic, of communicating, or leading by example. But tell us, what is Sachin Jain's take on surviving and thriving post-COVID?
I think, you know, it's an open world to answer. I know so many things that I can come to my mind, Anurag. But, I mean, the top few that come to my mind, I would say, first and foremost, you know, when you're building an organization, build values that are genuine. Right, because when times are tough, those values play out, and your teams play a humongous part in that. And the alignment of teams is so critical. I mean, you were living in a world where you would hold the meetings once in a month, get everybody in a boardroom, and have those, you know, jazzy meetings. Those days are gone, and everybody's on their own. There's a sense of trust that the whole sense of trust evolved.
Trust.
The sense of belief involved. The sense of helping one another in the new
even
world.
Empowerment. Because you have
empowerment, totally. So that's one aspect of it. The other one I would say is really the you know, the fact that decision making, which and I think every leader comes with their own sort of strength on how fast, quick, and how they decide things. And I would say in the post-COVID world, make decisions more. And I'm saying that...
So decisions that you're taking on monthly, quarterly basis, possibly...
Do it hour by hour.
Daily basis.
I mean, I would say that as a leader, you'd be better off making more decisions. And I'm not saying that all of the decisions are right or wrong. But the luxury to sit on non-decision-making and, you know, postponing decision-making is over. You know,
right.
The fact that if there are four options ahead of you, choose that one option today, you might fail. But change, succeed, it's such a dynamic world that not every decision will result into a right sort of result. But since it's so dynamically changing at every level, that you've got to decide faster and move on. And I would say lastly, reflect back on what your core business really is. What is your product? And I think in my case, I've been very lucky that it's this miracle of Mother Nature, which I think you know, you need to reinterpret in your mind that it's not just about that value on the paper and on that calculator, but it does more. And I'm sure everybody can find those things. But I think the belief...
You say intangibles. What you have, intangibles, yeah, become even more important on the post-COVID world.
Exactly. So, you know, it's the role of a reader to sort of bring out specifics to what those roles of your industry or your product are, and really bring strength out of that. Because that's, in our case, that's long-term. I mean, there's a huge headwind coming in. It's already there. But we are fundamentally clear that in the long run, the product is desirable. The product reflects love. It reflects, something that you can pass on to perhaps your daughter or your mother, or give it off. So I think it's a very, I mean, the reflection that I had on what really diamonds are has been strongest ever.
Thank you, Satyam. I'll ask you my last question. If you had to predict the economy 60 days to 120 days, 2 months to 4 months horizon, do you see the economy being strong? Do you see the consumer demand being strong? Or when do you see the consumer demand coming up? Of course, the variable is, when does the corona kind of taper away? When is the vaccine comes out? These are two big kind of variables. But beyond that, what are you hearing from your peers? What do you see from the position where you sit in, where you talk to retailers, you talk to everybody in your value chain? What is the view emerging?
I don't know. If you were to ask me this question about a month back, I would have given you a vague answer. Today, I can give you some certainty because, you know, some of our markets have been open now for 4 to 5 weeks. And I can tell you that as human beings, you talk about resilience, that exists inside us. And the speed to normalcy will be very fast. You know, and when I say fast, will differ between age groups within certain cities that are impacted more or less. But I foresee that we will move towards normalcy with, of course, breaking rules and following certain rules and all of that. And infections will happen in the whole sphere. But I foresee that by September, October, we should be in a fairly better position. And I can talk more depth about our business. And I think, you know, if you're saying 100% recovery, forget it. I think we cannot plan those situations. If there's about 50 to 60% recovery at Diwali time, you know, we're good. We should gun for that, prepare well for it. You know, do a lot of preparation. Because
when Diwali is on 14 November.
Yes, but I meant September, October, when this festive season begins. We should be that recovered. And I would foresee that January, February will be perhaps an 80% recovery. That'll be my
opinion. On that note, I would like to let you go. We are out of time. And I just want to, if you had to give a message to hope to people on this broadcast and people who read your interviews subsequently on the site, in the magazine, what's your message of hope?
Well, my thing is that, we all are in together. We all will come out of it together strongly. But it'll depend on how you deal with this. So lockdown period, I think in some way was a gift. For a lot of people, it still is partial working from home and all those things happening. Utilize this time to be 10% better. I'm defining it. For me, it's 10%. You could define it 5, 20, whatever. But be better mentally, physically, emotionally. And all of that we can do.
Thank you,
it's going to be a better world out there.
Thank you for being optimistic and authentic. I think if you have these two qualities, you will come out better on the other side of COVID. We wish you luck and we look forward to joining you, Sachin, on another conversation on one of our platforms and hopefully very soon. Thank you,
Anurag. And I must also share with you, our viewers, that one of the most optimistic and cheerful persons I met is you, Anurag. You also bring in that cheer, that ease. And I'm sure you're dealing with this time very well with your team and your family. Wish you all the best.
Because you asked me about personal, I'll tell you, the first 1 week, I was very confused. I was very, and I'm an action-oriented person. I take decisions fast. And I was ruining over many things. But I think after the first 5 or 7 days, I got into an action mode and I haven't stopped since. I've done my bit to kind of reinvent, make the best of what we have. And it is a positive moment towards realizing your dreams. And also understanding that we all are connected and living in the day while we plan maybe for a week, 10 days ahead. But we're not planning like 6 months, 1 year. We'll take the day as it comes. I'm sure we'll be able to deal with it with the right intent and the right action.
Phenomenal.
That I think we'll do okay. So thank you, Sachin.
Fantastic.
Words. As I said, kindness is the biggest wealth one can have and can give. So thank you for sharing that wealth with me. I look forward to another conversation.
Thank you so much, Anurag. Thanks for having me on. Thank you. Lovely.